Welcome to session 19 of my SwiftUI for iOS 15 course. This is where we're going to learn how to set up a very custom tab bar animation with the little circle in the background, as well as the line that is going to switch back and forth between the tab items. First of all, let's set up the style. We're going to set a circle right behind the material. So we're going to go to the background modifier, and right after that, we're going to set another background modifier, then set a circle parentheses. Now we're going to add a color. Right after circle, we're going to set fill dot pink. If we want to control the size of the circle, we're going to set the frame width to 80. So this is the part where we're going to try to put the circle behind each of the tab items. Now, because this is specifically behind the material, we can't just use a background modifier to the VStack. That would be very easy. But furthermore, we can't do that inside a loop because then you cannot animate it seamlessly between the items. That's why it has to be outside of the loop. Now, the challenge here is to place that exactly in the same position as the type items when selected. And there are two ways that I found that does that. Now there's the more complicated way, which I did before knowing this one, which is to detect the position using Geometry Reader. We're gonna learn that later. And then there's the simpler way, which I just figured out recently. And it's a really interesting technique that is using spacers. So let's put that into practice. We're going to compose the circle with spacers. And in order to do that, we're going to need to embed inside an HStack. And then we can move to the first item by using a spacer like this. We also want to mimic the positioning of the inner elements by adding the same padding. So we're going to put that on the HStack, padding horizontal, comma 8, then fix the indentation. So you can see that this is working fine, but then the question is, how do we move that to the other items? Let's experiment. Now, if I put another spacer before the circle, then you can see that it's back to centering. What if I put two spacer and one? Oh, this is interesting. I'm able to get to the notifications. So when I saw that, I realized that I can essentially just set conditional spacers based on what is the selected tab. And honestly, sometimes the simplest solutions are the best. So let's try and do that. We're going to set if selected tab is equal to dot library, curly braces, then we're going to set to a single spacer. Next, if selected tab is equal to explore, then we're gonna set also a single spacer, because then we need to have one spacer that push it to the second and then two spacers that aligns it to the second. The same for the notifications, we're gonna need two spacers before the circle. So if selected tab is equal to notifications, then we're going to set two spacers. All right, now we can delete this one, and then we can essentially try to do the same thing for the first two tabs. So if selected tab is equal to home, curly braces, we're going to have a single spacer. If selected tab is equal to explore, we're going to have two spacers. As you can see, explore needs two spacers plus one spacer on the left. And then finally, if selected tab is equal to notifications, then we're gonna set a single spacer. Now I realize this is a little bit repetitive, but at the same time, for what we're trying to do versus the complexity of detecting the position, updating an array, this is actually easier to read. And then we learn how to use spacer to align elements. So I think that's a win-win. So let's put this logic in practice. when I have learn now selected, the only condition that kicks in is this one, meaning that we have a spacer that push the whole thing to the left. When I have explore, then we have two that are kicking in. So we have this one that sets a single spacer on the left, and then we have this one that sets two spacer in the right. As a result, when I click on explore, you can see that it's going to the second one, and then notification goes to the third one, library goes to the fourth. That's pretty interesting and fun at the same time. But most importantly, we can animate this, and we're gonna go to the button action. So the button here, the first curly braces, when we set the state change, we can wrap this inside with animation and curly braces. Then we put the state change inside and voila, it does animate, which is really cool. We can even make it bounce back by setting parentheses.spring. We're gonna use the response and we're gonna set 0.3. So the first value is how fast it is at the beginning, and then the damping is how fast it is at the end. We're going to set 0.7. For the blend duration, we don't need it, and you can definitely play with the values, but you can see that we have some bounce back. We can make it more elastic, for example, by setting less damping, so 0.5. You can see that it bounced a little bit more. Now, it is important to note that when you use Spring, the further the distance, the more it's going to bounce back. So you can see that from here to here, it has more velocity. From here to here, it has less. Let me put it back to 0.7. And the other thing we're going to change is the color, just like in the design. In order to do that, we're going to go to the tab, and then we're going to add a new variable to our data model, which is called color of type color. Because we're using the type color, we can set comma color and then dot using teal or one of the preset colors. So the first one is going to be teal, and then color, the second one is going to be blue. The third one is going to be red. The fourth, pink. Perfect. With this, we're going to go back to tab bar and we're going to set our state for the color. So state var color of type color is equal to dot teal by default, which is the color of the home. Then when we press on the button, so in the button action, we're going to change not only the selected tab, but also the color. So color is equal to item dot color. Then using the state color, we're going to change the color of the circle. So just put color. Resume this, and we have our color, and it's also transitioning beautifully. Now, what about the line here? Well, we're going to use exactly the same technique, except that instead of using a background, we're going to use an overlay. And we can just copy the same code, including the background modifier and the parentheses, paste that, then this time we're going to use overlay. Now you can see that the overlay goes above the material sheet versus the background is in the back. And we're going to use the same system of spacers, but we're going to change the circle itself. So let's start with a rectangle. Then we can color that by using fill and using the color state. We'll set the frame size width 28, height 5. We're going to set rounded corners by using corner radius of 3. Then we want to make sure that this is roughly the same size as a circle so that the container is consistent with each other. As a result, I'm going to set a frame with a width of 80. And maybe to make it a little bit more centered, we can set it to 88 as well as 88. It was kind of hard to see the circle in the background, which is why we had to fix that. But thanks to the line, I can easily see how it's centering with the icon. Next, I want to set this at the very top instead. So we're going to use frame again, max height dot infinity. Set the alignment to top. Awesome. Let's give it a test. So I select explore and boom, we have the beautiful animation with the line and perfectly synchronized with the circle. One last thing that we can do since we have a circle in the background is to use blending mode so that it looks a little bit more like what we have in the design. I'm gonna go to the button and here where it says foreground style, I'm gonna add a new modifier called blend mode. Select a tab is equal to item.tab question mark. Then I'm gonna set overlay if selected, otherwise dot normal. Thanks to this, the color blends a little bit better. Now you can see that the effects on the tab bar are very custom and you can customize the design any way you wish, including the shape of the circle in the background, the colors, as well as the line, how thick you want that to be, the icon, the text. And that's the beauty of creating a custom tab bar, is that you can essentially do anything you want with it. And we managed to get the same functionalities as well. Now, you might have noticed that this is not adaptive yet because we've been using a manual width for the container of the circle and the line. So in the next session, I want to show you how to detect the size of each tab item by using Geometry Reader, but also how to store that value and pass that to a state and then update our views. I think you're going to love that technique, so I hope to see you in the next session.